My name is Abbie Barnes. I've grown up exploring the country's most stunning landscapes, be it through day hikes or multi-day long distance walking. And now I know one thing for sure, I'm pretty addicted to backpacking.
I've decided to walk each of the UK's designated national trail paths to explore exactly what makes each route unique. They amass to over 2,500 miles, traversing exposed moorlands and rugged mountaintops, pass through bustling market towns and historical cities. They follow world-renowned archaeological discoveries and enter some of the most tranquil valleys and mystical forests this island has to offer. It's not surprising then that they attract walkers from all over the world, many seeking a challenge, others simply wanting to break free from the monotony of everyday life. My reason for hiking the trail is one of discovery and awareness. Getting outside and spending time in nature is now more important than ever before, with obesity rates maintaining record highs and mental health issues affecting over 1 in 4 individuals. There are incredible landscapes all around us, but so few of us dare venture out into such seemingly inhospitable lands. Well, I'm here to show you otherwise, and inspire you to don your walking boots and spend more time in the wild. I've faced my own trials with mental health, but alongside building a strong support network, getting outside and taking the time to reconnect with nature has helped me move further along the road of personal discovery. So, here's me inviting you to join me on my adventure through this beautiful country. There will be challenges along the way, and we're not guaranteed to succeed, but it takes a courageous heart and a brave soul to commit to the unknown. Now all you have to do is decide that you want it more than you are afraid of it. Are you ready? Let's go. The Yorkshire Wolds Way travels 79 miles from Hessle on the shores of the Humber Estuary to Filey Brigg on the east coast just south of Scarborough. Boarding the first of 3 trains that day, I was excited to experience the tranquil countryside the trail is said to offer and enjoyed watching the landscape change around me as I headed towards London and then north onto Hessle. I knew I was getting close when the iconic Humber Bridge appeared on the horizon.
Made it. 3 trains and a taxi ride later, I'm in Hessle, or Hessle, as everybody else seems to be calling it. The official location, the start of the beginning of the Yorkshire Wolds Way by a busy road. I'm not going to say anything about the weather, except there's none of this, which is awesome. The train went past the Humber Bridge. Oh my gosh, there it is right behind me. Check it out. That's so cool. So that's the Humber Bridge. And I'm heading to the Country Park Inn. I'm not starting my walk today. I'm staying overnight at the Country Park Inn and I'll begin my walk tomorrow. So that's my first job, find the Country Park Inn. I have a map. Okay. By Hessle Station. I've got my Google Maps directions. Oh my gosh, that's warm. Sun. It's awesome. Heading in the direction of the Humber Bridge because I know that the Country Park Inn is actually slap bang on the Yorkshire Wolds Way, right on the trail. The trail runs right outside of it. So that's where I'm headed right now. Head west onto Southfield towards Woodfield Lane. So that's what I'm doing. And there is, as I head towards the Humber Bridge. It's dominant beast of a construction. It's huge. That's absolutely massive. Gosh. I mean, like, I knew it was big, but not that big. That's like proper big. This is this road.
The noise from the A63 was pretty deafening, and I was really looking forward to leaving it behind.
Okay, behind that red mast is a stone. You might not be able to see it right now, but it is a man-made carved stone. Some would call it a monument. And I know what that stone is. That's a marker for the Yorkshire Wolds Way. Now, I didn't think this was the beginning, but it might be. stupid map. Check this out though, isn't this not absolutely incredible? Humber Bridge. That is just a beast of a bridge. 1.5 miles long, or nearly 1.5 miles long. Sheesh. That's massive. Check it out. This stone marker symbolises the beginning of the Yorkshire Wolds Way, which starts here, Hessle Haven, and stretches that way, kind of northeasty, all the way to the Filey coast. I'm kind of speechless. I mean, check out the Humber Bridge behind me. How awesome is that? Nearly 1.5 miles long. What an iconic view. Absolutely incredible. It's just stopped snowing. The sun has come out. Reasonably warm. I mean, the wind is picking up, but it's okay. Blue sky above me. That's something. Big tick in the box. And I'm here on the shore of the Humber Estuary. And the estuary stretches all that way down to the North Sea. And you see these white pebbles which line the shoreline? That's chalk. And they're white because the Yorkshire Wolds Way is chalk stone. Drains pretty well, very good for agricultural uses. And that's what I'm going to be walking on, the Yorkshire Wolds. But I've got to get there first.
The River Humber is a short river, travelling just 59 miles from source to mouth, although at its widest is 13 kilometres wide. As the second largest coastal plain in the UK, the Humber has been rightfully designated as a European marine site, with intertidal mud and sand flats, salt marshes, coastal lagoons and sand dunes. The area boasts a rich array of wildlife, such as grey seals, marsh harriers, bitterns and the primitive looking lamprey.
Now, according to my map, I pass underneath the Humber Bridge and the Country Park Inn is just literally the other side. So I think we're nearly there. Oh, there's a sign, look.
The construction of the Humber Bridge took 9 years, and until the Great Belt Bridge was built in Denmark in 1997, it stood as the largest single-span bridge in the world.
I have found a windmill. Hessle windmill. Hessle Whitting Mill. Whitting Mill? Ooh. Clearly not in use now.
The mill was built in the early 19th century to replace an earlier horse-powered mill. It had 5 sails, but these were discontinued when the mill was converted to gas in the 1920s.
I'd say that looks like a good sign. Haha, get it? The Country Park Inn. Slap bang where I'm headed. And, oh, check it out, the first acorn sign. So the National Trail goes that way, along the shore. I wonder what that sign says. Yorkshire Wolds Way. Very cool. That way. That's the lodge I'm going to be staying in. And as you can see, it's really trying hard to snow. It's really, really trying. There you go. That was a green mark. Yes, success. How absolutely stunning is that? I just can't believe how it's cleared up actually. It's stunning, absolutely stunning. If it weren't for the sound of the cars, it would be very peaceful. And it's interesting, so we've got all these barges going past. I read about them, but I didn't see any earlier and they all seem to have appeared. But this is pretty cool.
I spent the rest of the evening watching the golden sun disappear over the horizon and then enjoyed taking in the nighttime views of Hull and the Humber Bridge twinkling in the darkness. I couldn't wait to head out on the trail the next day.
Right then, goodbye Country Park Inn. It has been good. Thank you for a nice night's sleep and a very comfortable bed. Literally 50 metres outside of the lodge is the footpath. So the first part of the route today of the Yorkshire Wolds Way along the shoreline of the Humber Estuary, and the Humber Bridge will be watching over my back there. Right then, oh dear, let's go. Day one, 24 miles all the way to Goodmanham. It's a little chilly, snow showers, not too bad. I'd rather it was snowing than raining, not gonna lie. Let's just take it steady. It takes as long as it takes. We got here then. Our first acorn sign.
The route followed an easy cycle path with the estuary on the left and the Hull to Selby Railway on the right, which was officially opened in 1840.
So I've just had a pit stop. I've not even made it to North Ferriby yet, but I decided I really don't want to sweat a lot today because the wind chill is quite significant and wind whipping away your sweat can leave you feeling quite cold indeed. So I've taken off a layer, put my woolly hat away. I'm very aware of these ominous looking black clouds in front of me, but for now just keep walking to get to North Ferriby and then we'll turn inland towards the black clouds. Riverside walkway. 1930s, Bill and Ted White, schoolboys, searched in the clay and peat beds and found wooden stakes that showed marks of a cutting, suggesting land had been used by ancient man. 1937, low water, three massive oak planks, first thought to be a Viking longboat. Further excavation showed that the remains of a boat dating back, as was later discovered, to the Bronze Age, 2,000 years earlier. How absolutely, completely incredible is that? Bronze Age boats. And it just shows that clay, so the anaerobic conditions, can really preserve organic materials very well. And then here behind this plaque is a kind of replica, almost flowerbed version of a boat, a Bronze Age boat. That's quite big actually. And that plaque over there says Riverside Walkway, and that's what this whole area is. It's part of kind of reclaimed land, or reusing the land that was once quarry land. This area is really quite industrial. Here we go, this is the split. You've got the high tide and the low tide route, very conveniently signed, and this is the reed pond here. So this is where you make the decision based on your observations of the shoreline as to which way to go. Now I'm going to go the high tide route because that looks high to me. Now I'm not an expert, but it doesn't exactly look like a low tide. So high tide route it is, which is this way. So this should take me into North Ferriby, up to some roads, and then I'll work my way through the village back onto where the National Trail for the low tide route should be.
Passing the reed pond, I headed through North Ferriby and on towards the A63, passing the All Saints Church on the way.
So that's where the onshore path comes up. So I'm back on the official route now, and I need to cross this road and then the big A road down there. I need to get to that bridge just behind those trees. Ruin! Look how pretty this is. All of the hazel leaves are coming out. Goodbye, noisy road. I'm now heading away to the peace of the Yorkshire Wolds. Welton, here we come, through the terrace plantation. So just up in the trees over there is a grey spotted woodpecker. He's gonna have heard me now. He's chirping away. Just come across this marker. Filey is 74 miles away. I like that, that's cool. So you can see by that sign that we head up past the quarry. Wow, look at that water. Yum. I'm not saying anything about quarries. I'd like to get a view down into it, but I know what quarries are like, hiding things.
I was amazed at how quickly the drone of traffic and quarry machinery was left behind, and soon found myself settling into the walk, accompanied by the song of blackbirds, robin and finches.
just see some final views there of the Humber Estuary in the distance, which makes me realise I didn't say a proper goodbye to the Humber Bridge. That's quite sad. So I'm just on the outskirts of Welton now. Those are cool buildings. Little bridge with the river down there. In fact, I'm gonna go have a look at that. Wintringham, 4 miles away. That's the next village I'll be walking through.
The official route merely skirted the edge of the village before heading north and onto the Weltondale estate, and then onto Weltondale itself.
I've just stopped actually to grab a drink and just to sort out my shoulder because it's getting a little sore. And I thought, well, I didn't really have much for breakfast, so I might just have a quick bite to eat. So I've got my Dorset flapjack here. This is the apple sultana and cinnamon flavour. So I thought I'd just try a little bit, see what it tastes like, give me a bit of energy, and then keep going. Tastes like Christmas. Here's a note for walkers. I've just come up the track. The path is on the other side of the track, so I need to go over this fence. Hence, the route goes that way. Whoops. Ow, that's brambles. Perhaps one-handed wasn't the best in the entire world. Ugh. Oh, I survived. Right back on the Yorkshire Wolds Way. Whoops. This way. It's a little pond. You can see I'm really in farmland now. So I just follow this track all the way to Wintringham now.
It was a truly humbling experience to have the sun shining overhead, which brought the scenery to life and freshened the air with the smell of blossom and other flowers.
69 miles. So I've just looked at the map and read the instructions, and as you can see, I don't go into Wintringham itself. I turn right off this road before I hit the village. So my option is to go into the village and have a look, or because I want to try and make up some time, because I have been taking a lot of pictures, I think I'm just going to follow the route. So in Wintringham itself, there's the church, there's the memorial hall. Really nice places worth visiting that I'm not going to visit. But if you were walking today to South Cave, then you could very much go into Wintringham and spend a bit of time there, have a look at the tea rooms and just chillax for a bit. But I'm going to push on today, especially now that the sun's come out for a little bit. So I'm going to utilise that. Here we go. And this is the turning. So head straight down there into Wintringham. But I'm going to go right back towards the north and on to South Cave this way. Here we go. Here's the All Saints Church of Wintringham. Not actually in the village itself. The Yorkshire Wolds Way goes right past the front of it.
Built in the 12th century, the church is one of the most picturesque in the East Riding of Yorkshire. It was subject to major restoration works in the 19th century, and then had an extension added in 2009.
It's a really tranquil area. And there's this little stream running alongside.
Pushing on, I headed towards South Cave and the halfway point for the day.
Gorgeous. Hello.
Oh, you're so lovely. Can I ride you and you can take me home and see my animals? Oh, and you so nice. Isn't he so nice?
Down and up it is then. So I'm now walking towards South Cave. I'm literally about to turn right away from South Cave. But if you wanted to stay there, if you were doing the 13 miles today as your first day, then you just keep on walking and you'll hit the village. But you can see the sign there just on the side of the road. That's where I'm heading, is to the right, just along this field boundary here. Found these national trail benches here. They've got a poem line written on them. We shed them one by one by shattered field and barley seas, until the way is open for echoes of us, made strange by wind, deserted barn and shifting trade. Of shadows of the Humber, our mouth springs that speak in tongues of thirst. And here comes the weather.
Walking in a winter wonderland.
It's snowing! So I've just stumbled across a little wild vineyard. So this is a place that people can visit, Marketplace Farm, and you can try out their wines and the things that they produce. Of course, nothing's in season at the moment, but especially if you're walking this route in the summer, that might be something you'd like to check out.
I was really enjoying the route so far. The signage was incredible, so I rarely had to use my map, but when I did, I often chuckled at place names, such as Sweaty Hill Plantation and Sober Hill. The weather also kept me entertained, alternating between extremes of soggy snow and blazing sunshine.
There's another sign. 64 miles to Filey. Just come across this beacon, erected by Rowley Parish Council, Queen Elizabeth II, Golden Jubilee 2002. So I've come out of the wind. I'm walking through this dale now, and it just feels like the calm before the storm. There's a few black clouds around, but it's just so quiet. Gentle breeze and that's it. So I'm a bit like looking around me like, what's gonna happen? Something's gonna happen. But this dale is absolutely stunning actually. Just dropped my map. See that black cloud up there? I've got my eye on you.
The route dropped in and out of deep grassy valleys, lined with chalk and flint stones. I saw buzzards floating on the wind and rabbits playing in the corner of fields, and even disturbed a pair of sleeping roe deer. On the valley tops, skylark songs filled the air, the only sound in the peaceful atmosphere. Emerging onto the B1230, I headed up onto the High Hansley Circuit, which offered extensive views across the land.
So 10.5 miles back that way to South Cave. So it should be about 0.5 mile to Goodmanham now. And this here is part of Springdale, which runs along the Hudson Way, this road. Not the one I'm about to go down, that one, but rather this one along to there. Named after the famous railway builder, George Hudson. But unfortunately I'm not walking on your road, George. Or your railway. I'm walking this way to Goodmanham. Here we come.
Just off the track is Rifle Butts Quarry, a nationally important geological reserve managed by the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust.
I have found buildings. It's a good sign, I'd say. Oh, and a tennis court. Anyone for a game of tennis? Yes, please. Here we go. Manor Farm Cottages. Right. Find the L-shaped building.
I've been upgraded to a cottage for the night. Absolutely one of the nicest places I've ever stayed in. A beautiful room in a calming location, and I slept like a log. I would definitely recommend.
Straight out the door. Goodbye, Manor Farm Cottages. Hello, Yorkshire Wolds Way. So now, walk through Goodmanham, pick up the signs again, past the church, which is actually just there, and head on out into the wolds. That was easy enough. What, like 100 metres down the road? And I picked up the signs again. So, Londesborough, 2.5 miles away. That's the first place for me to get to today. And that is Goodmanham Church.
The sleepy village was the scene of a crucial event in the coming of Christianity to Britain, when Edwin, the Saxon king of Northumbria, was converted to the Christian faith in AD 626, and built a Norman church in the place of a Gothic temple.
Just about to pass under this old railway bridge here, but listen if I just stop. Nothing but the birds. Okay, maybe a car that way, quite far away. But nothing but the birds. That's perfect. Good morning, world. Here I come. Look like they're having fun. Nice weather so far, huh? Check out this view to the west. That is the Vale of York, the vast expansion of flatness.
Heading down into Londesborough took me over the artificially created Londesborough Lake and through the main estate, dating to the 17th and 18th century.
Morning. Welcome to Londesborough, a village and landscape steeped in history. Everything you see around you, the buildings, the peaceful parkland with its lakes and cascades and wood, has been fashioned by generations of people who have lived here over many centuries. The Remmons Radio Road that passes through the park, as does the Wolds Way, one of the 13 national trails. Ah, it's 15 now. So much has happened that a book has been written on Londesborough history. Whoa. Cool place. Heading down into Nunbourne Home now. Oh, limping.
Nunbourne Home is a tiny village, home to just over 200 people. The path passed by St James's Church, which, after falling into disrepair, was completely renovated in the late 19th century. The tower itself was added in 1902, and incorporates the original Norman arch from the earliest build.
Wow, look at the wind, sky, rain, snow stuff. Oh dear.
The route once again headed up through farmland and opened out with incredible panoramic views. This stretch was one of the most memorable, not just for the scenery, but also for the chilly weather that came in. Before long, I was engulfed by dark clouds raining sleet and hail. It was generally a fun experience, but I worried about moisture reaching my camera gear. When able to lift my gaze, I could see the land slowly being transformed and softened by a damp covering of snow. I made sure to pay close attention to the route, because there are many paths heading down between different dales. At least I wasn't the only one out and about. I bumped into a group of walkers doing a local route, and even they were getting a bit disorientated. Joining the road, I opted to pass on the route that skirted around the village and headed directly along the track into Huggate. It was a shame, because I missed seeing the remains of an Anglo-Saxon cross, but my main priority at that point in time was to get my tent up and dry everything out. I was staying at the Wolds Inn and pitched my tent around the back in their beer garden.
Considering this region is supposed to be one of the driest in the UK, there has been a lot of precipitation falling from the sky in the last couple of days. Just gonna put that out there. Oh, shucks, all my stuff's left outside. Socks, gloves, help! So last night, I saw a lady just as I left the Wolds Inn. She said it was -4. I was very, very cold, I'm not gonna lie. Curled up like a ball, trying to stay warm. And I had all my camera gear in my sleeping bag as well, just to keep that slightly away from the elements. The Wolds Inn itself, I didn't feel like I was received all that well. I walked in there and pretty much got told, go away. Bearing in mind at this point, I was soaking wet, freezing cold in that snowstorm. But never mind, so I pitched up, had some food there, made sure to get a decent meal because I needed a morale boost. And then this morning, I set my watch alarm for 6. Lo and behold, I wake up at 7:30, having missed 3 alarms. And that's simply because I couldn't hear them, because I was well and truly wrapped up in my sleeping bag. So it's now 8:30, I'm on the road again, hoping the weather will stay pleasant. I've got 18.5 miles to get to Wintringham today. Deserted medieval village, I'll be going through there. But otherwise, it's mainly farm and walking, a few dales here and there. But I'm praying that the sun will shine so that I can dry things out a little bit. And I'm gonna get there as early as I can so as to get things up and dried out, because tomorrow is looking very wet indeed. Nevertheless, I'm on the road. Let's do this. Here we go, Friday Forbes, my first settlement, 2.5 miles away. Let's get there. Oh, that's quite a view. It's pretty cool. Just found this eggshell. It looks like whatever bird it's from has just hatched this morning. If the stone is wet, it's raining. If the stone is dry, it's not raining. Shadows on the ground, sunny. White on top, snowing. Can't see the stone, foggy. Swinging stone, windy. Jumping stone, earthquake. No stone, tornado. It's brilliant. Morning. Anyway, so here we are, Friday Fort, which is the approximate halfway point on Yorkshire Wolds Way. Yay! Time to celebrate. There's a lot of archaeology on the Yorkshire Wolds Way, but most of it is buried, it's covered by grass, and all that's left is like mounds and bumps basically. However, place names are a really good way to tell something, or to learn about the history of a village or a town. Friday Thorpe, so the Thorpe of that name, suggests that this place was first established by Danish invaders, and I just find that really, really interesting. You can imagine the archaeology around this place, what lies buried beneath the ground. Highest village in the Yorkshire Wolds. That's cool. 561 feet above sea level. So we've walked from here, Hessle, all the way. There's Goodmanham, that was our first day. Second day to Huggate. We're now at Friday Thorpe, and we're heading up to, where are we going to today? Oh, there's no one here. Wintringham, which is somewhere around here, and then the final day all the way to Filey Coast. Boom. Look at the sleeping ducks. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to wake you up. <It's> so cute. Now the route doesn't actually go through here, but I just wanted to have a look because this is St Mary's Church.
The church dates back to the 12th century, and is known as a Sykes Church, as it was restored by C. Hodgson Fowler for Sir Tatton Sykes in 1902, an English landowner and stock breeder known for his horse racing.
I guess this is what yesterday would have been like, except I couldn't see anything because I was being snowed on.
I felt so privileged to be able to spend time walking through the tranquil region of the Wolds, experiencing the surrounding chalk hills that have been preserved for over 1,000 years.
You can see the tracks of a rabbit. That's cool. So I'm just walking down into this dale and I can see some stoneworks just over ahead. Sort of circular pattern. Now I remember reading about that, and a lot of people thought it was some kind of archaeological feature, when in fact it's actually quite a modern construction. Although when I get down there, we'll take a closer look. There may be a plaque or a board or something saying a little bit about it.
The earthworks were part of the Wonder series of sculptures along the way. This particular one was called Waves and Time, and they all worked together to increase enjoyment and awareness of the route.
It would appear I've made some pals.
Thixendale is peacefully nestled at the meeting place of six dales, but a closer look at a larger scale map reveals 16 valleys, which is where the name Thixendale was thought to originate from. In the town itself is St Mary's Church from 1870, a small store and a pub called the Cross Keys.
Well, this is making life interesting. Just as the weather is apparently starting to come back in, I've got this slippy slope to navigate. I've already nearly had a tumble once. And the snow isn't really making it any easier. But to be honest, it's the mud. It's, a little treacherous, but it's all right. Just gonna find my own way down, I think. Oh, blimey, see.
The route climbed up to the highest point on the trail at 700 feet, and with no hedges in sight, it felt as though I'd entered a snowy prairie rather than managed farmland.
34 miles. It's very wet underfoot, as you can see, but I think mainly it's the snow that's caused this. Well, that's pretty cool. Just approaching the deserted medieval village of Wharram Percy. You see the 12th century church there, the old pond, and the rest of it really is just mounds and bumps on the hillside where like peasant houses were and other buildings. But look at that, what a beautiful, beautiful area. So I believe the path now takes me down past the old village itself. So let's have a wander down, maybe have a stop for a drink.
Wharram Percy is the best preserved ruin of a deserted medieval village in England. There's evidence of at least one Iron Age house and lots of Roman villas, but the real growth occurred under the Anglo-Saxons. At its peak, over 150 people lived in the village, farming the surrounding hills and worshipping in the St Mary's Church. However, by the mid-14th century, the Black Death and major changes to farming practices saw its population halve, and the last house was abandoned around the year 1500.
Well, that was cool. So Wharram Percy, the deserted medieval village, was very interesting indeed. I would have liked to have spent longer there, but I'm kind of keen because I know the weather's coming in, so I'm kind of keen to get to my site as soon as I can, which is probably about 8 miles away, because I just realised my campsite's actually beyond Wintringham. So whilst Wintringham might be 6 miles away, I've got another couple of miles the other side of that.
Anyway, so I just had a really lovely chat with two guys just in the car park at Wharram Percy, and they're both backpackers. One of them's a personal trainer, one is a forest school, who works with a forest school. And it's just so interesting to hear other people's perspectives as why they love getting out and about in the outdoors, what it means to them. Obviously it's a chance to catch up, it's a chance to clear your head and just to experience some awesome landscapes. So that was really nice to meet them, and actually they're the first people I've stopped and had a chat with on the whole route, so good job.
Wharramler Street was the next village I passed through, but as usual I didn't see a soul.
Turning over a new leaf, this farm is a member of the nationwide organisation LEAF, linking environment and farming. The vision production of wholesome food can be combined with care for nature. Everything we do on this farm is a result of a careful decision making with thought for quality, profitability and the environment. This is agriculture that consumers can trust, farmers are proud of, and is good for wildlife and the landscape. Oh, that's fab.
So, I'm walking through an environmentally considerate farm. Good job, farmers.
Just as the weather starts to come in, well, over there anyway, sign saying 5 miles to Wintringham.
Now it's a case of legging it as fast as I can and trying to beat the rain slash snow slash sleet slash wind. Yay! Pressure's on, guys. Caught in the sky, you're on. Boom.
Trying to beat the weather, trying to beat the weather, trying to beat the weather, trying to beat the weather.
29 miles to go. Doo-doo-doo-doo.
I headed up onto the ridge and through the Fizgig Hole plantation. A Setrington beacon marked the 650 contour of the land, although I didn't feel particularly high until reaching an opening at the end of the plantation.
So that settlement you see there, that's Wintringham, and then you see the track running up parallel with the edge of the woodland or the plantation, and there's a track going in front of the plantation. So the campsite I'm looking for is going to be around there somewhere, so I can see where I'm going. Unfortunately I can't fly, so I need to continue down this hill and then go right and then go right, a nice big circle
round to Wintringham, and then on from there to the campsite.
Wintringham Beck was a bit bigger than Whitestone Beck I'd crossed a few miles earlier, but still boasted a pureness characteristic to rivers flowing through chalk landscapes.
That's pretty.
Wintringham itself appeared to be another sleepy village. If I'd had more time and was walking in the summer, I would have visited the nearby lavender farm, just half a mile up the road. The path passed St Peter's Church, a rather large church considering the size of the village.
So I know that the camera's kind of steamed up, but this is no illusion. I think this is the steepest climb on the entire route. But the turning to my campsite is at the top, so I have no choice but to scale it.
And scale it I shall. Oh, okay, I'm done.
I'm really struggling to keep my camera demisted, but I've come across this. This is the landscape and archaeology project as part of the Wanderer project that goes alongside all the benches that we've been seeing. I was really hoping to get an awesome view here of the Vale, but alas, it was not to be.
Eventually, I made it to my campsite, a soggy mess and coated in mud. The owners were kind enough to let me stake out in their drying room for the night, and once dry, I headed back out as the skies cleared and watched the spectacular sunset.
Morning. I'm just leaving Wolds Way camping and caravan site behind. really cool site that I did enjoy my stay. They have really good facilities. Really great people running it as well. Hilarious. And that's just what you need for a morale boost as the weather comes in. So anyway, it's a pretty chilly morning today. The wind is definitely blowing, well, picking up anyway. And, you know, I'm feeling okay. My feet are a little sore now. I'm not gonna lie, getting them into my boots was a bit of a struggle. But otherwise, raring to go. So it's just gone 7 o'clock. I made the most of having everything dry by just starting earlier. 21 or a little bit more miles to go today, all the way to Filey. And then that's it. The end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way. Oh, this might be a tight one. Come on. Just. The trouble with like kissing gates is they're not always made big enough for people with a giant backpack. I've had a couple on this route that have been too small, so I've had to climb over them, but otherwise it's been really, really good.
The trail is the first route to be officially free from stiles, making for easier walking and less muddy spots.
So the first settlement I'll be going through today is Sherburn, and then 4 or 5 miles on is the next village. They've got bigger gaps between settlements. Well, I've got bigger gaps between settlements today. So whereas the last few days it's been kind of every 2 miles I've hit another one, it's more like between 5 and 6 today. So all the more reason just to take it steady. Anyway, I love walking early in the mornings. It's so fresh and all the birds are singing and it's so quiet out. And the sun just casts this wonderful light on all of the fields.
As I pressed on towards Ganton, I recapped over the interview I'd had a few days earlier with Malcolm and Patrick from the National Trails.
So I'm here with Patrick and Malcolm from the National Trails. Thanks for joining me, guys. I really appreciate you coming out through the snow and blizzards and everything. If you just wouldn't mind telling us a little bit about your roles working for the National Trails.
Okay, so I'm the National Trail Officer for the Yorkshire Wolds Way, and I kind of have an overview of the route as a whole. So it's trying to make sure that it's the best quality it can be because it's a national trail, but also it's looking at the promotion, dealing with the website, dealing with walker inquiries, go to exhibitions to promote the route, that sort of thing.
Kind of the whole package, really.
Yeah, that's right. And Pat's role is a little bit more specific, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm responsible for the maintenance of the trail. So okay. That means looking after all the signposts, making sure the gates are working and all the path surfaces are regularly cut back and removing obstructions, you know, fallen trees come down and checking bridges. And
it's kind of all,
you
know, the
basically
stuff.
Yeah, all the practical stuff. Basically, yeah. Making sure it's in a good condition for people that want to use it.
Well, I have to say the signposting has been perfect so far. Yeah,
good.
All wet kinds of weather. So I've had my map tucked in my pocket and I'm just like, right, stuff the map, I'm just going to follow the signpost.
Yeah. Well, that's good to hear. Yeah. Yeah. That is feedback we get quite a lot. Is people say it's the best signpost of the trails, and we like to hear.
Oh, no, so I think that's really, it's important, really useful. It's good.
I'm fairly keen on trying to attract lots of new people onto the trails as well, and like map reading is one of the things that lots of people find quite difficult.
Yeah.
And that's a barrier to them sort of being able to come out and enjoy the countryside.
But it's a nice route. I've really enjoyed it so far, but it's a nice route for like first time long distance walking, isn't it?
Yeah.
So why is the Yorkshire Wolds designated as a national trail? What makes it unique and stand out for its individuality?
I think, you know, that tranquility is part of the whole thing. But I think it's the, it's this way you can escape. With our kind of landscape, you really can escape. Mm. And we have these just fantastic dry valleys, which you'll have been through some of now.
Oh, they're lovely.
Kind of green rivers, as people see them. And they're like, you know, they have been for thousands of years. And they're pretty unique, really. Mm. But the thing is, because of where we are, they're much quieter than other places. You know, if you went down to South Downs, South Downs is absolutely gorgeous, fantastic. There's a lot of people around.
Sure.
Whereas when you come to the Yorkshire Wolds, even though we're very happy to have more people here, it's not overcrowded.
The Wolds and the Yorkshire Wolds Way are very, very popular, particularly on a weekend. People doing, you know, short short circuits really, you know. Yeah. So although you don't get huge numbers of people doing the national trail from like Hessle to Filey, you know, 79 miles, you do get a lot of people doing say 5 or 6 miles, you know, on a Saturday or Sunday along the Yorkshire Wolds Way, you know. Yeah, it's very popular.
So what would you say to first time backpackers about to head out and walk this trail? What would be your key piece of advice to anybody looking to walk the route?
I think for first timers generally, you still need to get a few miles under your belt in training, because you can't, even though this is an easier route, it's not dead easy, you know, you've still got ups and downs, so you need to get that, a little bit of experience of day trips behind you. Go to the website where all the details are there in terms of accommodation and information. My contact details are there, so you know, it's important if people have questions they can just contact us and you know, we will answer them. So you know, anything that they're unsure about, how to get to the start, back from the finish, you know, places to stay, all of that kind of information we can give to them.
Yeah, I have to say I used the actual National Trails website. I found it really very useful for planning the route.
Good.
So yeah, thanks for taking time out of your day.
Thank you. It's fine.
Hopefully
nice
the
to
rest
meet
of the walk will be equally as pleasant.
Yeah, and good luck with it.
Having travelled through Ganton, I passed Ganton Hall, a grand Victorian building tucked away on the Ganton estate. The village itself is famous for its international golf course, which has previously hosted the Ryder Cup, Amateur Championships, and the Walker Cup games.
12 miles to go! Whoop whoop! Yes! That looks pretty soggy. Oh well, nothing I can do about it now. The weather ain't gonna stop me.
RAF Saxton Wold is a Royal Air Force remote radar head within the United Kingdom Air Surveillance and Control System. The site has hosted an early warning function since the 3rd century AD, when it was host to a traditional warning beacon. It was on a fence near here that I had my first trail injury, catching my finger between two posts. The rain washed all the blood away though, so it was fine. Since it was my last day on the route, I slowed my pace and allowed myself to rest more frequently. I'll never forget the peacefulness of the landscape. I just didn't want to leave. Pretty soon, the rain came lashing down and chilled me to the core, but I kept my spirits high by tuning in to my MP3 and having the occasional dance.
So I'm at the point where the route splits, so the Century Way goes that way and the Yorkshire Wolds Way goes that way. It says in the guidebook if the weather's bad to go along the Century Way, that way, but I don't know, I followed the official trail all the way until now. I don't really want to leave it, so I'm just going to follow the Yorkshire Wolds Way all the way to Filey now. We're getting there. We are getting there.
I've just had my first views of the dramatic sheer cliffs near Filey. Check it out. Wow. They really are very dramatic indeed. Pretty much the first rugged features on the whole route itself. Hi! Oh, I'm sorry. Don't run. You're too cute.
Even though the geology was chalk, which allowed for speedy draining, the ground had become saturated, and I found myself practicing my skating skills. It really was very muddy. Muston was the last village before reaching Filey, just 1.5 miles southwest of the finish. The route took me through grassy fields and farmland tracks until I emerged behind some houses at the top of the village of Filey. The countdown had begun as I walked off the last mile of the route, passing the train station and a beautiful memorial garden and arch, remembering those lost in the First and Second World War.
Whoa. So I've just walked through Filey and I'm so very, very nearly actually at the sea. And look at the cliffs over there. They are incredible. Wow.
On the waterfront stood a giant sculpture of a fisherman, titled A High Tide in Short Wellies, and a poem that made a powerful statement about the decline of the fishing industry. It really was quite moving. Feeling the end calling my name, I didn't stop for long, and pushed on out of the village, up onto the country park, and on to Filey Brigg.
So I can see the end, I can see the stone marker. I'm pretty much at the top of Filey Brigg now, at the end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way. Just got to get to that marker over there, about 100 metres away, and then I've done it. And what an incredible location to finish the walk in. Absolutely incredible. Look at that, Hessle, 79 miles that way. That's awesome. And there's the stone marker. Well, here we are at the end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way. We've travelled 79 miles from Hessle all the way over there next to the Humber Estuary to here, Filey on the North Sea. And I'm standing just above Filey Brigg at the official marker stone at the end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way. It has been a crazy day, a crazy journey in fact. We've had some incredible weather. We've had snow and blizzards and torrential rain today, but there has been some sunny spells. But either way, the weather hasn't put me off. I've enjoyed every step on the Yorkshire Wolds through the rolling chalk hills and the stunning little dales. It's been extremely tranquil. It's really cleared my head, I have to say, and it's not been challenging at all, so I've just been plodding along enjoying myself. The wildlife has been pretty spectacular. I've seen deer, some buzzards, lots and lots of different bird species, and actually where I am now, the cliffs here on Filey Brigg, bird watchers paradise, full of migratory species, I have no doubt. But for now, I'm just going to enjoy my last few moments here at the end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way, just kind of recap mentally the journey that we've taken. And I'm sure in the next few months I'll be back here celebrating the end of the Cleveland Way, which comes from over that direction. But I'll leave you with the stunning views across the cliffs near Filey Brigg. The end of the Yorkshire Wolds Way.
That evening, I stayed at Filey Brigg Caravan and Camping and rested up before my final travel day home. In contrast to the day before, I woke to a scorching temp and blazing sunshine and was stunned to find Filey alive with holidaymakers and visitors. It felt strange to be in such a noisy location after having spent the previous few days alone in the Wolds, and I missed their gentleness as I made my way towards the station. Still, Filey was a fantastic location to end the walk, and I knew I'd be back. But until then, I'll treasure the memories of the tranquil landscape I travelled through on the Yorkshire Wolds Way.